Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala Nabiyyir Rahmati wal Huda Muhammadin al-Amin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa tabi'in wa man tabi'ahum bi ihsanin ila yawmiddin. Wa ba'd. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire household, all his companions. May Allah bless them all, and may He bless every single one of us and grant us goodness in this world and the next. Beloved brothers and sisters, the religion of Islam is a religion that has a lot of rules and regulations. That is in fact such a great blessing that Allah has taught us and trained us and given us instruction without us having had to put much effort in order to govern the lives of mankind, the lives of His creatures, so that they may achieve success in this world to start with and then the next. So that's the first point we need to get to understand. Allah says at the beginning of Surah Taha, Taha ma anzalna alayka al-Qur'an litashqa illa tadhkiratan liman yakhsha. Starting beginning of the surah, Allah says, we have not revealed this Quran to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in order for it to be a means of distress for you. That answers a lot of questions. It answered the questions even of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. And it will answer the questions of a lot of Muslims and non-Muslims. Why are there so many rules and regulations? Well, they are not there in order to be a means of distress, to cause you discomfort, to block you from doing nice things. No, they are there in order to act as a reminder for those who have some form of consciousness of Allah, the humility, humbleness. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the fear of His, in a way that we understand His mercy. Ameen. So, if Allah has placed rules and regulations in my life and in yours, they are there only to ensure that I lead a happy life, that I am content, that I can smile upon all conditions, that I can be a happy person. From this we understand that the more we adopt the instruction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the happier we will be as people. And the less happy we are as people, it is indicative of the fact that we are further away from the instruction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If a man or a woman has nothing in this world but they are still happy, perhaps they are still close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He did not promise us that we will have the millions and the billions of the world. Nor did He say, you will all have good health, none of you will lose loved ones. If you are close to me, I will ensure that nobody dies amongst your relatives. Did He say that? Not at all. If you are close to me, you will never get sick. Did He say that? If you are close to me, nobody will be jealous of you. Nobody will be irritating your life. He never said that. Did He say, if you are close to me, then I will ensure that you are the richest person in society? He did not say that. But He did say, if you are close to me, I will ensure that you are always happy. You are always content. Contentment needs to be translated and understood. Very simply, it is a condition of the heart that is upon peace, upon tranquility at all times, subhanAllah. The mind is also very content. The mind is happy with what Allah has provided. And this must not be misunderstood. It does not mean that I must sit back and relax, be lazy and not do anything. No, I work as hard as I have to. But whatever I achieve as a result, that will be from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I am happy with it. And when I face adversity and difficulty that comes in my life, I should do as much as Allah has given me the capacity to do, in order to protect myself and in order to comfort myself, together with praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, knowing that whatever Allah wills shall happen, and ultimately I will still be happy upon that condition. May Allah grant us goodness. Some people are sick with a small flu and they are so depressed. And other people have been diagnosed cancer. May Allah grant you cure. But they are still happy. They die with a smile, going to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, knowing that there are those who might die before them who have not been diagnosed with any disease whatsoever. This is the plan of Allah. So it all depends how we look at things. When we perceive things, when we look at what happens to us, when we look at people around us, how we look at them is what will make us better people or worse. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to look at things correctly. The reason I start in this particular way is many Muslims feel that Islam is so tough to follow just because they have laziness in them. Just because they want to do as they desire. If your son happens to dash across this road outside this Mount View Masjid and he's just running across, what will you do? You love your child, don't you? You will yell, you will perhaps scream, what are you doing? You might run behind him, hold him, you might admonish him, don't ever do that again. Why? He's doing something dangerous, he's going to die. And he looks at you and says, Dad, we were only playing catches. You know, catches. We only were touching each other. So I was just running away from everyone. Dad says, you know what? You could have died. He says, well, I didn't die. That's what we do with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He tells us, don't head in that direction. You'll lose contentment. You'll break your home. Don't go in that direction. It will result in your financial downfall. Don't involve in this thing here. You will become sick. Don't do that, you will lose your akhirah. Don't do this because this is what will happen. And we say, no, I was only playing catches. That means I was only fulfilling my whims. I needed the money, so I had to go into the deal. Whether I was deceiving people or not was besides the point. At least I got the money. So then when Allah says, you could have lost, people say, well, I didn't lose. You see the catches example? Exactly the same example. When we are told, get up for Salatul Fajr, we say, well, you know what, I don't have to. Come on, nothing's happening to me. I haven't been getting up for Fajr for the last 10 years. Nothing happened to me. I'm still a healthy person. Well, you could be running across the road playing catches for 10 years. The 11th year still has to come. Allahu Akbar. May Allah protect us. So we don't understand sometimes that Allah made us. When He says, get up for Salatul Fajr, that is the way of opening the door of contentment for that day. You haven't got up, the door is closed. You want to open the door, say for example, you've missed the salah. May Allah protect us. But man nama an salatin aw nasiyaha falyusalliha idha dhakaraha. Whoever sleeps over mistakenly a salah or forgets it, some human reason, as soon as they remember, they must fulfill that salah as qada. So they've missed the waqt, they've missed the time of that salah. As soon as they can, they must fulfill it, recompense it. Still by the will of Allah, we will be able to open the door of goodness for that day. Still by the will of Allah. It may not be as wide a door as it would have been had we got up. But by the will of Allah, He will still open it for us because we've got a concern to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if we don't get up for Salatul Fajr, do you know we will pay for it? Allahu Akbar. And I'm being very serious. For example, Allah tells us to dress appropriately. That's a beautiful word. It's a broad statement. It's translated by different people differently because each one is on a level. But we can improve on our dress code. And this applies to the boys as well, the men as well. When we talk of dress code, it's never only for the women, like what some people think. No, it's also for the boys, for the men. Wearing too tight. Your jeans are very tight, my brother. Don't do that. You know what? We can see half your backside, my brother. Don't do that. Allahu Akbar. May Allah protect us. You know, we need to improve our dress code. If we don't, my brothers and sisters, we pay for it. And if we say, well, I've been wearing this for so long and I haven't really paid for anything, so who are you? Well, you might come and tell me, I'm free to do what I want. Why are you telling me? Well, you're just as free to run across that road here and now. That's what it is. And then we might say, nothing's happened to me. Well, you know that when Allah says something, He definitely has kept behind it my protection and yours. All you've done is you've stripped that protection. That's what you did. Took it off. So when a person is no longer under the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, anything can happen. Not necessarily immediately, but after some time. But with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is a door. And that door is the door of repentance and tawbah. Allah loves you. Every single one of you. Allah loves you so much, that we feel the link with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when the devil tries to come and distract us or draw us apart and distance us from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we still feel the guilt. That guilt that is felt is actually the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we have that makes us feel that particular way. Amazing. So Allah makes us feel, because we love Him and He loves us, He makes us feel that guilt. You know, you've done this. Now, don't ever do that again. So you say, Ya Allah, I will never do it again. I seek your forgiveness. And Allah says, I am so happy that you have turned to me. I was waiting for you. I have forgiven you. And you are as pure as the day you were born. Allah is waiting for you, my brother. Allah is waiting for you, my sister. He is waiting. Therefore, let's turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before we are bumped or knocked down by the vehicle as we are dashing just to enjoy our little game in the world. Because this dunya is full of lusts and desires, and the deen has come to us to control all those desires and lusts. It's all about control. And with that control, Allah says, I will give you happiness, contentment. A man commits adultery. He's worried. Is she expecting? Is she pregnant? Is she not pregnant? What happened? Is it my child? Oh no, now what? So the man is living on edge. The payment for that adultery is far more than the few minutes of pleasure that the man might have derived or the woman. But we don't realize it, because for us, dashing across that road takes 3 seconds. Allahu Akbar. When you're knocked down, what happens? Allahu Akbar. You are in the hospital for 2 years. For 3 years. So it is not worth it at all. Allah just puts rules and regulations, not for us to be distressed, but in order for us to achieve contentment. When you have access to sin and you have not sinned, the contentment you feel within your heart is something unmatched. We cannot describe it. We can only feel it. The love of Allah. And we remove from our hearts the love for sin to the degree that we become so happy when we don't sin, and we tend to forget about it. We don't even bat an eyelid in that direction as time passes. May Allah make us strong. Because every sin has a bad effect, and every bad habit has a bad effect that will come to haunt us or to visit us unless we repent. And if we repent and turn, sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may forgive us completely, and sometimes we may taste a little bit of what we have done as a result. If a man, for example, decides to cut his hand off, so he's cut his hand off, and then he says, oh Allah, forgive me, I made a mistake. You know, we were just playing games to see who was brave. I was the bravest, so I cut my hand off. Allah may forgive him, but he will have to live his life without one hand. That's what it is. So Allah has forgiven him, but he's got something he has to live. A person who's made a mistake and they have, for example, engaged in illicit behavior, fathered a child who perhaps, may Allah protect us, is illegitimate. That particular child, as we would know, innocent child. May Allah grant us all protection and goodness. But the person will have to live with that and face reality, even though Allah may have forgiven them completely for the sin that they have committed. Subhanallah. I hope we understand what is being said here. We are living in a country that we enjoy the freedom of almost everything in this country. Freedom of absolutely anything and everything. And Allah says, there are rules and regulations. Allahu Akbar. So what we did, through the freedom, we chose to be Muslimin. Through that freedom, we chose not to engage in certain things, because those who are exercising that freedom to the extent of making them do what we would have termed very unacceptable a few years ago in the same country, speaking of the fathers of that freedom, who would have looked at it as something that was outside the fold of that freedom, to be honest, they are leading a life that is absolutely miserable. A few days ago, I had a chat with a group of youngsters, non-Muslims. And I was talking to them. We were at an airport waiting to board a flight. And they were asking me questions, you look like Jesus and so on. And I started talking to them and answering them and telling them things and so on. And at the end of the day, I asked them, so where are you working? They all had very good jobs, brilliant jobs. They had good salaries. None of them were married. I said, so what's happening? No, no, we don't want to tie the knot. What? So I said, so what do you do? He says, you know, we earn our salary and we must live it up. I said, what do you mean live it up? He says, I drive a Porsche. The other guy says, I drive some car. The other one says, I drive something else. And he says, come Friday night, we are partying and we enjoy ourselves. We go, we have a ball of a time there at the club and we really do whatever we have to. The music is kicking. The girls are there. The women is there. The wine is there. Everything is flashing. It is such a kick. We actually have whatever weed and whatever else, the drug and all sorts of things we want. Everything is done and it's such a beautiful life. It is so sweet, so smart because we've got the money and we can have whatever we want and that's it. And I'm just listening. Then I dropped the bombshell. And I said, so according to you, that's what life is all about. What if you were to die? What have you done to prepare for the day you die? You know what I was told? Please, don't even talk about that. That means you are living a deception. You really don't know what life is. And then I asked them more questions. And believe me, they were all depressed. Depressed, but they did not know they were depressed. They are living this fantasy life. They are paying for just fulfilling their desires. They have no clue what's going on. They don't even know their own limits. And they think life is all about partying. To be honest with you, they have no relations in the home. They have, their friends are the only, or should I say, the only people they mix with are those who think the same. And those who are having the same, they party all day, every day that they can. Come weekend, it's a party. Come Monday, back to work. That's like a machine. Where's the spirituality? Do you pray to God? No, we don't. You don't pray to a God? You don't believe in a God? Well, you know, God exists, but you know, we need to just enjoy life. We're still young. So have young people not gone before? Well, you know, God is understanding. He'll know because He gave us the money and all that. So He'll know that, you know, we were just partying. Astaghfirullah. And I'm sitting and I speak to these people and I think to myself, there are actually, these are non-Muslims, but there are actually Muslims who do the same thing. To them, life is all about partying. Is that what it is? So now you have the depression. There comes a stage when those bad habits return to haunt you. You get to an age. Okay, then I started speaking now a little bit more. So when you are 55, what will happen? Well, we'll still party. What if you have arthritis? May Allah protect us all. What if you have a disease, you can't dance anymore? Well, then we'll sit and watch. And what if, you know, you're not attracted to, or the women are not attracted to you anymore? Well, we'll pay them to be attracted to us. Look at the answers. And these are people who are talking to you and they are to themselves. They think we're making sense. Then I said, well, what if you get to 70 and you now cannot move beyond the hospital bed? We'll see when that happens. I don't think it'll happen. I go to the gym anyway. I go to the gym. Oh, wow. So it's becoming a culture of godlessness. Remove Allah from the equation completely and just enjoy your life. That's what people are trying to say. Yet we don't understand the rules and regulations Allah says. We have placed them so that you can enjoy your life in the true sense, the contentment. When you get to the age of 30, by now you should have a child or two by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You need to pass the torch on, the candle on, because we need to carry on. You know, today I was speaking to a group of friends and I was saying, leaders are those who prepare others for the leadership that they have at that time. So a leader is known not by his followers, but by the number of people he has prepared to take over that leadership. That's a leader. So we are all leaders in the Sharia. Every one of us, kullukum ra' wa kullukum mas'oolun ar-ra'iyyati. Every one of you is a shepherd. Every one of you is a shepherd. And each one of you is responsible for his or her flock. So when I am growing a little bit older, it's not all about enjoying and partying and so on. So many young people who have had a brilliant upbringing given to them by their parents, fall into bad company for a few days, and that changes their life irreversibly for a long, long time. Or should I say, in a very dangerous way. How? I give you examples of so many young girls. Astaghfirullah. May Allah protect us. The number is increasing, sadly. Who are from brilliant families and brilliant people. Very good at heart. Very kind. Very compassionate. Perhaps even sometimes fulfilling their salah and so on. Get into the bad company for a few days. And sometimes they're talking about, hey, I'm looking for a place to have an abortion. We know what I'm talking about. No one knows. Mom doesn't know. Dad doesn't know. Nobody knows. But this little child is depressed. Why? Because of the visiting of that bad company back. And it's haunting us so soon, so quick. It happened so fast. And what was it? It was the flashy life. We went into the nightclub. We were dancing. We were a bit high. That's the word. As it is, the high heels are there. But nowadays when they say hi, they're not talking of hello. Nor are they talking of the high heels. They're talking of something else. Allah protect us. So they were a bit high, and at the same time what happened? All their happiness went down the road by. Goodbye. To what? To your future. Gone. It could be. Allah may forgive you for the sin, but you may have to live with the stigma of it for the rest of your life. Allahu Akbar. Why? Because that bad habit we had of going out to party every time, partying, partying. You say, but life is boring, man. I'm a Muslim, I'm not supposed to go anywhere. No, is that it? You're supposed to be using your energies in a proactive manner. You're supposed to be using your energies. Do something good. The problem with us, we don't have enough little youth clubs where we're doing the right thing. Reach out to people. Have a little halaqah of Quran. Have something going, and don't make it boring, and don't make it too long. You know, we had a beautiful recitation of the Quran here this evening. To be honest with you, it was so beautiful in more than one way. One is the recitation was powerful. The meaning was solid. The pronunciation was brilliant. But the timing of it was just dead right. Subhanallah. If someone nowadays with the youth stretches a lecture a little bit too much, the next lecture, the youth are not there. So when you have a little club, for example, for the youth, young, whoever it is, boys or girls or whatever it is, don't waste their time on things that really would bore them. So you have a sheikh come in and he's talking for 2 hours and everybody's yawning. And you know, he's such a dry person looking at you, no smile, no nothing, blasting you one way. Who will come back to your halaqa the following week? Nobody. To be honest with you, you might also have doubts. Allahu Akbar. Because we did not do it the proper way. But keep it interesting. Ask the people, what would you like to do? And I firmly believe, having mixed with a lot of different type of youth, that we need to engage in different types of activity to protect us from bad habits, to protect us from something worse. Today I was reading, for example, an email someone sent me to say, you know, it's prohibited to visit, or it's prohibited to go to a comedy show, for example. Okay, technically speaking, we might say it's a waste of time. But if you are to weigh a nightclub where there is things happening, and you are to weigh a Muslim who's coming to you and telling you something meaningful, perhaps on a lighter note or something else, the thing is, when we are weighing the two, in that particular case, we will revisit how we look at this particular item. Because I tell you, we are drowning. The youth are drowning. And if people don't know that, they are not swimming. That's the thing. Really. The youth are drowning. And why are they drowning? There are so many bad habits that are made so beautiful to them that they think life is all about those things. And they do not look at those habits as bad anymore. Do you know, when you sit, and this is now the adults as well, in front of your television, and you're watching movie after movie, it is such a bad habit that will come back to haunt you. One is, you become brainwashed by styles and things that happen, the way to talk, the way to deal. Another, it wakens the shaitan in you, because there's so much of pornography and nudity, even in those movies that they say suitable for family viewing. That now, you find your children have watched somebody who's perhaps engaging in behavior that is not befitting a Muslim in the movie, and they start doing it in real life. Why? Because we were sitting with Dad. It was a nice movie, Dad said. Dad wants to watch it again this Sunday. There you are, Dad. Who's paying for it? That bad habit came back to affect your own children. So it awakens within us the devil. We start doing things we don't realize. I could have cut the lawn outside for my neighbor. Hello? I could have cut the lawn outside for my neighbor. I don't think we would actually do that in a rush. For us, he must pay me. Who does he think he is? We wouldn't even go and offer. It would have been better for you to wash your neighbor's car. He might give you a ride in his new Mercedes. Allahu Akbar. But we don't think of that, because for us, that's something rotten, that's bad. Whereas that's something good. We need to have the heart to do that. But if we have these bad habits, where we just want to sit in front of the television, we don't take our children out, we don't show interest in our own wives and family members, parents and so on, later on, life becomes so boring for everyone. Then when the child is suffering in one way, we come back and we say, why is my child suffering? We don't say, where did I go wrong? What happened? Perhaps I've been doing this and that. So we have talks of this nature to wake us up. Take an interest in your children. You don't know. Just spending moments with them, talking to them, it's far more interesting than the television. You know, sometimes when I am at a hotel and you have a television, I tell myself, not even for the news, I'm not turning this thing on, because I've got a phone, and on there I can just check what the news is. I can see what I want, and then I can turn it off. You believe me, the amount of time that you save by turning off that thing is amazing. It's amazing. What do you need to sit and watch movies? People say, well, you know what? It's just a movie. I can sit and watch it and so on. What meaning does it have behind it? What is it that you're trying to achieve? If it is a lesson, if it is something powerful and so on, by all means, alhamdulillah, we may make use of some of technology. But if it's just a waste of time, it cannot become a habit. No. People sit on the phone, and one of the worst habits is to make yourself available for everyone who wants to get hold of you. Everyone. So you're sitting on the phone, you're either on WhatsApp or BBM. Those are the famous ones now. On Samsung, you can actually get BBM. They struck a deal. I'm being honest. You can go to Samsung apps and check the BBM. They'll give you a PIN and everything. But to be very open with you, we need to limit the time we are on our phone. If you cannot, it's a bad habit. And it will visit you. Visit you meaning, it's going to come back to haunt you. Because if you are accessible to everyone, not everyone has a good intention. And you, sometimes the devil might come to mess your intention. So you say hi to someone, and before you know it, your intention is so bad, because the devil has come in just because you've got the time to do that. So you start saying, I love you, to people that you don't love. And here's your spouse, you've never said it to her. And I know of one man, you know, a person that we became close to later on, and his wife saw a message on his phone, and it said, I love you. And the message came up. So she went into the phone, and this is actually another bad habit, to pry into the phones of others, no matter who they are. You pay for it. Actually, even if it's your spouse, if you pry into your spouse's phone, believe me, you pay for it with your happiness and contentment. You know, you might look at me and think, well, aren't I allowed to do that? The reality is, that is their relation between them and Allah. If they are fulfilling your rights, leave them alone. Their link with Allah is between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those who want to disagree, don't agree. You pay for it. That's all I'm saying. We've seen it happening. When a man says, I love you, he does not mean it 9 times out of 10. The only time he means it is when he's telling it to his wife, by the will of Allah. So this man, he says, I see the people are just looking at me. Hey, I'm honest with you. I'm telling you, you pry into the phone of your spouse, for example, you will see things that are really not worth seeing sometimes, and you won't understand them, and you create a big discord when the man really loves you the most in the world, and your relation is destroyed because you saw something and he could not explain to you exactly what was going on. And you played the role of Allah, because he fulfills all your rights, everything put together. And you think, like someone says, you know, my husband cheated on me. And I say, no, he didn't. He cheated on Allah. If you say he cheated on you, he might do it behind your back. But if he's convinced that he cheated on Allah, he'll stop it completely. See the difference. But sometimes we don't understand. He's my property. Well, if he's your property, then yes, he cheated on you. And you know what? You're not going to be happy. Allahu Akbar. Because we are not as merciful as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I've spoken to people whom they've said, one thing's gone wrong in my marriage, but I'm ending my marriage. And then I tell them, there are other people, 30 things have gone wrong in their marriage. They stayed together and they dealt with all 30 things, and all of them are eradicated, and they are the happiest couple ever. That's how it works. I see someone nodding their heads. Tell her. She needs to hear. Allahu Akbar. No, we don't ask for trouble. So I was telling about this couple, and the wife sees the message. And then when she goes into the phone, like what I was telling you, when you have time, you say things to people, not realizing this is supposed to be diverted to your spouse. Then what happened? She saw more messages. I love you. I adore you. You are my this and my that. And then she confronts him and says, who have you been sending messages to? And this man was one sharp. Don't use this, please. He says, to you? What do you mean? Look at this. Who's this? But I thought it's your number. That's the number I wrote. Allahu Akbar. What do you mean? But I'm sending you messages every day. You're trying to tell me it's the wrong number. Allahu Akbar. May Allah protect us. Look at how man is visited by his bad habits. That's the point I'm raising. The same applies to a female. Visited by bad habits. They come back and they haunt you. Why? It was not worth it. So now you lose your children, you lose your spouse, you lose everything around you. Not everybody is understanding. And everyone's living a depressed life. Why? Because your bad habits came back to haunt you. A person who drinks a lot, they might say, no, I don't harm anyone. I just got a habit of a bottle. People tell you sometimes, you know, it's encouraging to note that they seek help. Yes. But at the same time, yeah, you know, I just drink a little bit. Wallahi, that is totally unacceptable. And if we are to continue with that bad habit without engaging in tawbah, perhaps it will come to visit us in a very nasty way. Very nasty way. People who have a habit of swearing. You know, some people, even with their friends, small little thing, you this, and they swear big swear words, but they're friends. They don't realize a swear word by nature pierces the heart, even if it is said jokingly, of the person whom it is used against. So if I'm joking with you and you're my best friend, but I have a habit of saying swear words, it's such a bad habit that even if you know that I'm your best friend and I'm just saying it, but it will pierce your heart in a way that one day you'll get so fed up of it that you will actually come out and get irritated and say, hey, can you keep quiet? You've been swearing me for so long and I don't like the way you're doing things. And then you say, but I thought I was your friend. Why do we say this? Allah says in the Quran, we have not revealed these laws, these rules, these regulations in order for them to be a means of distress, but rather in order for them to make you lead a content life full of happiness and contentment and full of success. So vulgar words are not to be uttered, even jokingly. Don't. But then we say, come on. You know, I've seen the young generation say, come on, get a life, man. What do you mean, get a life? We're trying to tell you something about the real life, the life after death. Subhanallah. You're telling us to start enjoying life. Is that what you call get a life? If anything, we have a better life than yours, my little boy. Allahu Akbar. May Allah grant us goodness. Why? Because we've disciplined ourselves. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. The bad habit of, for example, gambling. It is such a bad habit that if a person goes into it, there are two things that happen to start off with. One is the excitement, and the other is the tug of shaitan. So with the excitement, the person is now, whoa, I'm new in this thing here. I'm going to multiply my money and it's going to come. And you know what? That other uncle or that man or that person taught me what to do, how to do this thing here. I don't even know what we're talking about, but I just know that it's gambling we're talking about. But the details of it, don't ask me. You lose your money, believe me. So the excitement is there. Then shaitan pulls you. He says, no, just come once. Come, let's see. Then shaitan, the first time you win a bit. So my 20 rands became 40. And then the guy comes and says, imagine that was 1,000,000. It would have been 2,000,000. Because your 20 became 40. That was 100%. So that's the pull of the devil. So now we become more excited. So now what happens? I borrow from him. I take from him. Hey, I urgently need money. You know, I need this and I need that. And we get this and we get that. And after a while, we've gathered and collected so much of this wealth. And when we've got it all and then we go gambling, what happens? Boom. Everything lost. So I owe this man 200,000 and this one 400,000. And then I'm ducking, diving, no longer in the masjid, no longer to be seen, no more friends. And now I'm busy doing one thing and another. And I've got nobody around me. Why? You had a bad habit. It came back to visit you. That's all. And it visited you very severely in a nasty way, very serious. So that's why we say, quit the gambling whilst you are healthy and you haven't lost anything. And say, Ya Allah, I've made tawbah. I know I've seen so many lives being messed. Even if I didn't see lives being messed, the fact that you've prohibited it, I know it's for my betterment. Rather enjoy the 20 rands that you have than to wish for the 200 rands that you do not have. That's an Islamic law. Enjoy what you have rather than wishing for what you don't have. Because when you start wishing for what you don't have, you may start doing something wrong in order to get there, and you're never going to be happy with what you have. Yet, had you been looking at those who have less than the 20 you have, you would appreciate that 20 by all means. By all means. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us look at things in the correct perspective. We have the habit of laziness. Laziness visits us. When you are young and you're growing and your parents begin to tell you, you know what, you better work hard. And we just, you know, so what? My friends are playing, I need to go out. Yes, you play, but there are limits. Not all play. You need to make sure you work. The balance between work and play as you're growing up. Because if we are lazy, sometimes we fail. I know the exams are starting, inshallah, perhaps in the next day or two. May Allah make it easy for all of you, all those who are writing and all our children. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them and grant them success in the dunya and the akhirah. But without hard work, don't expect to achieve. Because laziness is such a bad habit that when you have important exams, very important, say for example, the end of secondary school or final exams at the varsity and so on, and you have been lazy. If we have been lazy, what happens? One failure can change our future sometimes. It can change the future. So now you have results that are mediocre. Are you going to rewrite or you're just going to be happy with those results? Well, when you go and apply, for example, for a job, you may not get the top-notch job because you were lazy. The laziness is visiting you. And it's knocking on every door that you're knocking on with you. Allahu Akbar. So this is why we say eradicate the bad habit. It has an effect and an impact that will come back in a negative way. We work on it. The laziness needs to go. And this is why we say if we were disciplined and we found joy in obeying the instruction of Allah and we were happy to get up for Salatul Fajr, your laziness is dealt with. It's dealt with. You are a disciplined person. When someone says, come on, get up, you're up. You know, when I need to sleep, I still have Salatul Isha to read. Let me read it, then I'll sleep. So you're a happy person because you are disciplined. So if you take a careful look at the laws of Islam, they actually prepare every one of us to become a proper leader. Proper leader. You have leadership qualities in you if you're a good Muslim. Why? Because you're a straight person. You're a happy person, you're a very just person, you don't have laziness, you don't have bad habits, you're a sober person, you really have time for your family, you have time for your relatives, you really are positively contributing to society and so on. All those qualities are qualities that are required in a leader. Tomorrow when you up for elections, for example, they will vote for you because they know this person is a proper example. This person really will do something good. So this is what Islam does. So never ever look at the laws of Islam and think for a moment that these are deceptive or these laws are there in order to make us depressed and in order to govern our lives in the wrong way. I always tell the young girls, and I'm going to say it again because it's very, very important. I always tell the young girls that, you know, when you do not dress appropriately, those who are attracted to you are those who like that type of dressing. So then you end up getting married to people who are attracted to the wrong things in you. So now you're married. And it might look all rosy because, oh, you married the Don. Allahu Akbar. Yes, and now you're excited. But 1-2 years down the line, when you want to become a little bit religious, do you know what happens? He says, hey, I didn't marry a nun. I didn't marry a nun. You now want to become a person who's so religious. I didn't marry a person who's like this. No. And then you struggle. Now in the home, there's polarization. One is in one direction, the other one is in the other direction. Why? Because initially when we met for the wrong reasons. I cannot develop anymore. So if you dress appropriately, properly, those who are attracted to that type of dressing will understand, or they will want you in marriage, for example, for the right reasons. And as they marry you, they will know we've married the mother of our children who will develop with us, not only to earn the closeness of Allah, but to prepare the next generations. And this is why we always say one of the reasons of divorce today is because people are irresponsible, very irresponsible. You have a person, he's married, but still 2 a.m. is with his friends. Where are you? Come on, those were my friends before you came into my home. Well, you should have rather married them. Allahu Akbar. It's true. Your life must change. You be back home. After Salatul Isha, you're there with your spouse. That is more valuable than being with 50 friends outside. Believe me. And one of the worst habits is to be outside after Salatul Isha when you're doing nothing constructive. And I want to end on that note. The reason is, do you know Salatul Isha depicts the end of the day? After that, you either do something constructive or recline. Go and sleep. Get up early then, and you can read your salah, whether it's fajr or tahajjud. 90% of sin is committed after Salatul Isha amongst the youth. The drugs come out at night. The clubbing at night. The adultery at night. What else? The gambling at night. Everything else at night. Most of it happens at night. So look at how blessed the teaching is. We get irritated when someone says, please, after Isha, go and sleep. If you want to change your life, get to bed early and get up early. As a good Muslim, your life will change. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. I end on that note, and I'm very, very serious about what I said. And may Allah grant us discipline in our lives in a way that we see the fruits of the discipline. Just like when you have a bad habit, you may see the haunting of it come back to us unless we engage in tawbah. We also have the good habits that will always come back with the fruits in order for us to eat from and to enjoy in the dunya and the akhirah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all discipline and goodness. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallahi wa bihamdih. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdika. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.